Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our NCERT classes. Okay, so today you have the history class, as we have already started this NCERT book. Okay, so I hope you are studying your NCERT books. So these lectures are basically very useful for those students who are preparing for civil services examination as well as other government competitive examination, because certain basic questions related to the your general studies been asked in almost all examinations, including civil services examinations. So you can obviously supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. Okay, so these lectures are immense useful for those students, and you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube for these lectures. These lectures are uploaded on the day-to-day basis on the YouTube, so you can subscribe our lectures. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first, what we have done in our last class, we have seen the different type of the land settlement system, the permanent settlement system, the Rayatwari settlement system, Mahalwari settlement system. We have also seen the doctrine of left. We have also seen the subsidiary alliances, right? We have seen the different features, right, through which the Britishers basically try to get the control over the Indians. Okay, so what happens is, why the people rebel in 1857? That was the first war of independence and after. Obviously, the policies which was made by the Britishers, right, that policies basically affected almost all sections of the population. Okay, whether the section of the population, whether the king, queen, peasants, landlord, tribals, right, soldiers, all different sections of the people basically affected due to the policies which was adopted by the British or by the East India Company. Okay, the Nawabs which were there in the West Bengal, so they lost their power, they lost their sovereignty over the land. Okay, so in the mid 18th century, right, so they have seen that Nawabs basically have, you know, frequently changed with the help of the Britishers. Okay, they have lost all their authority, they have lost all their power, they have eroded their power. Okay, and they have also lost their honor also, that we have seen in our last class. In 1801, the subsidiary alliances were imposed on the Awadh. Okay, in which the subsidiary forces is to be stationed over there. Okay, and the company basically, or East India Company basically, started planning to bring complete total end of the Mughal dynasty. Ultimately try to get the control over the vast Indian subcontinent. Okay, so first, one by one, we'll see what was the effect of the British policies on the different sections of the society. So first we'll see with respect to the peasants and the sepoy. Okay, so first of all, you know, as you know that as soon as the Britishers or East India Company came, right, so they have imposed very high taxes. Okay, and the method of revenue collection, which was very high, which was exorbitant, and the method of collecting this revenue was also very rigid. If you have seen in your permanent settlement system, the zamindars used to pay, right, that was talukdars used to pay the revenue to the company. If they are not able to pay, their land rights would be sold to the another zamindar, right? So the method of collection was also very rigid. Okay, and the taxes were also very, very high. So in that process, the peasants were basically exploited. The zamindars, they also lost their rights, because the Britishers basically sold the right to collect the revenue to the highest bidder, right? If the zamindar failed to repay back in terms of revenue to the company. Okay, now the Indian sepoy which were there in the company, right, in the employment, they were unhappy because they used to get the payment, allowances, conditions of service that are adverse to their position. Okay, for example, they were receiving the lesser salary as compared to the white counterpart who was there in the same rank, right? They were getting lesser allowances, and moreover, they were not entitled to reach to the top level of your, you know, hierarchy in the department. So they can reach up to the certain level in the department. So that was also, you know, the problem of the Indian sepoys in the basically in the company. And moreover, the new rules violated their religious sensitivities as well as belief, right? So the new rules that they have to serve, you know, across, you know, basically oceans, they have to serve across the country also, and crossing the oceans is tantamount to, derogating to the religious belief. Then the cartridge which was introduced in the rifle, right, that was made up of, the pig, right, basically the leather. So it was also against the religious practices. So all such new rules basically violated the religious perspective, specifically the Hindus in the company's employment. Now, obviously, there was also reforms that was implemented, but there was response to those reform. Okay. So the Britishers believed that the Indian society should be reformed, right? And the reformed society can be easily to be handled and can be easy to be governed. Okay. So the law was basically passed. Obviously, the Britishers also tried to put down some of the practices that was not good. For example, sati. So the Britishers passed that law to stop the sati, right? The Britishers also tried to get, the law to pass through for remarrying of the widows, okay? So various other reforms were also introduced, right, by the Britishers. Okay, now, obviously, the English was trying to basically divide and rule the country. So they were determined to wipe out the religion of Hindus and the Muslims, okay? They were basically, trying to implement those policies which were against the religious belief, right? So that they can easily get, administrative purpose, it will be easy for them. So a massive rebellion was basically started against the companies, in May 1857. That was the first war of independence. Okay, the sepoy basically mutinied in different places. And that was started from the Meerut, okay? And a large number of people, right, basically rose up in the support of these sepoy. So different sections of the population basically supported this mutiny, which was started from the Meerut. And that has, covered almost all part of the country. Okay, how this sepoy's mutiny basically reaches from Meerut to Delhi. So that was March 29th, 1857. A Mangal Pandey, which was a soldier in the company, right, which was hanged to death because he has attacked his officers in the Barrackpore in West Bengal. Okay, so he was hanged to death, and in response to, this, right, the Indian soldiers in the Meerut was basically, they marched to basically the jail to the Meerut and released the imprisoned sepoys that were basically behind all such incident. And then these sepoys basically reached to the Delhi on 10th of May. So ultimately, they basically, reached out to the Delhi in that 10th of May. Okay, and the regiment which was there in Delhi also, they also came in the support of this rebellion, which was started from the basically sepoys from Meerut, and they reached ultimately to Delhi. And the Delhi regiment also supported this one. In that process, the violence erupted and many British officers were killed, okay? And the arms, ammunitions, right, were seized by those sepoys, right? As well as various buildings which were associated, with the Britishers were also put on the fire, okay? And then these soldiers basically met the last Mughal ruler, that was Bahadur Shah Jafar, okay? And they proclaimed the Bahadur Shah Zafar as a leader. But Bahadur Shah Zafar was very old, right? Despite of that, they proclaimed him as a leader. Now, this rebellion, which was started from Meerut and which reaches to Delhi and to the different regions, basically, this rebellion spreads to the different part of the country also, okay? So, after the British were routed from Delhi, okay, there was no uprising for almost a week, okay? Now, the regiment after regiments at different places basically mutinied, okay? They basically participated in this rebellion. They joined together, right, at various nodal points, for example, Delhi, Kanpur, and Lucknow. they rose in support of this rebellion, which was started by the sepoys after the hanging of the Mangal Pandey, okay, at the Barakpur. For example, different leaders at the different nodal points basically supported this India's first struggle for independence. For example, from Kanpur, the Nana Sahab, then from Lucknow, the Birjis Qadir and his mother, Begum Hazrat Mahal, okay. Then from Jhansi, Rani Lakshmibai took an active participation in basically organizing a revolt against the British. Okay. Then the Rani Avanti Bai Lodhi of Ramgarh basically also raised. They raised the armies against the British, right? Who had taken the administration of her state. So various leaders at various nodal points, aroused against the British policies, against the British operations, right? And that was also important landmark in the occasion of this first war of independence in 1857. And then as soon as this situation gone out of hand, the company also fight back. Okay. Now, obviously the company decided to repress this revolt, because ultimately they have to repress, they have to control. So they try to repress this revolt, right, with all its might, with all its force. So Delhi was recaptured from the rebels, from the basically soldiers in September 1857. Okay, just 2-3 months later only. Okay, and the last Mughal emperor, that was Bahadur Shah Zafar, who was proclaimed as a leader, right, by those rebels, right, was also tried in the court. And this last Mughal emperor, Bahadur Shah Zafar, was sentenced to the life imprisonment. Right, and they have sent both the Bahadur Shah Zafar and his wife sent to the prison in the Rangoon. Okay, and the people continue to resist the battle which was started by the British, but the British had to fight for 2 years ultimately to suppress this massive forces of popular rebellion. So that the fragmented rebellion basically arose at different parts, and it took almost 2 years for the company to totally suppress this rebellion. Okay, let's understand what happens aftermath of 1857, that was the rebellion. Okay, so various important changes were basically carried out by the British. Okay, when they regained control by the end of 1857, that means they took almost 2 years to totally, to regain the control after the 1857 rebellion. Okay, so the British Parliament decided to pass an act, that was the Act of 1858, right? So they have transferred all power of the East India Company to the British Crown. That means this Act of 1857 have totally abstained the East India Company from any power, and has transferred the power of East India Company to the British Crown, right? The main idea is to have more responsible management of Indian affairs in the hand of British Crown. Okay. And as soon as there was, the forcefully taking of the basically kingdoms from, different rulers if they do not have the male heir. Okay. So, for example, Awadh was also taken over because of they don't have this, the legal heir. Okay. So, all legal chiefs, or all rural chiefs in the country that were ruling on that time, right, they allowed to pass on their kingdom to their heirs, right, including the adopted sons. Previously, this adopted sons was not allowed. So now the Britishers have changed their policy. Now they have allowed that now they can adopt the son and they can pass their kingdoms in their hands of their heir. So a lot of changes have made by the British government. Okay, now how the story, which is basically related to this imperial capital of Delhi, has changed. So that you have to see, first of all, so how the different cities basically came under the colonial rules. So first of all, the most part of the Western world modern cities emerged with the industrialization. Okay, India also got impacted because of this industrialization. Okay, for example, in 18th century, the three important presidency cities, the Calcutta, Bombay, and Madras, rose in the importance in terms of the industrialization. And Britishers also took active interest in the industrialization of these cities. Obviously, there was some flaw in the industrialization. The Britishers only want to have the more and more revenue that to be carried out and that to be taken to the Britain. Okay. So with that process, the de-urbanization took place. Okay. And many cities in the 19th century, right? For example, the Machilipatnam, Surat, Seringapatnam, they lost their the sense of the urban city because a lot of other avenues related to the development of industries also lost. Okay. And Delhi was the capital for more than 1,000 years, right? Obviously, with some gap. The Shahjahan built the capital in Shahjahanabad, which was in 1639. Okay. And during Shahjahan reign also, the Delhi was important center of Sufi culture. Okay. But there was a sharp division between rich and the poor at that point of the time also. Okay. Now, in 1803, when the British gained the control of Delhi, okay, now what happens is the modern Delhi developed after 1911 when, you know, the Britishers declared the capital of British India as Delhi. So the Britishers made the modern Delhi as a capital of the British India. Okay. Now, as you know that the Delhi in the first half of the 19th century, okay, so in the Delhi, actually, you know, the Britishers lived along with the wealthiest Indians in the walled city of Delhi. Okay. Now, in that, you know, co-association with those, the native Indians, the Britishers basically learned, right, the Urdu, Persian culture. So they basically learned to enjoy this culture, poetry, and also they participated in the local festival also. Okay. Now, what the ultimate aim of the British? The British want to completely eliminate the Mughal past, or they want the Delhi or the people of Delhi to completely forget the Mughal past. Okay. So the areas around the fort was completely cleared of the gardens, pavilions, and the mosques. Okay. Now, in 1870 also, the walls of the Shahjahanabad, which was the capital of Shahjahan, which was broken to establish the railway, right, and which allowed the city to expand beyond the walls, because ultimate aim of the Britishers to forget the Mughal legacy, right, in the mind of the people. So they started clearing these gardens, pavilions, breaking down of these walls to construction of railways, expanding the cities, and etc. Okay. And after the revolt of 1857, okay, the Britishers, try to make the Delhi as a capital. So many spectacular events basically took place, right? So first of all, the Viceroy Lytton, which organized the Darbar to acknowledge the Queen Victoria as an Empress of India. That Darbar was organized in 1877. Okay. And in 1911, when the King George V was crowned in England, okay, a darbar was basically also held in Delhi to celebrate this occasion of, you know, the crowning of King George V, right? And at that occasion, the darbar was held, okay, and in that darbar, it was decided that the Delhi would be, or the capital of the British India would be shifted, right, to Delhi from Calcutta. So ultimately, in the darbar, which was a commemoration ceremony of the crowning of King George V, okay, in the darbar, the British India, or the capital of the British India, was basically transferred or shifted from Calcutta to Delhi. Okay. And two important architects, the Edward Lutyens and Herbert Baker, these two architects were basically called to design, okay, the new Delhi and its buildings. So it is a design. Okay, to design, as you have seen that there is a unique architecture, okay, which was designed by Edward Lutyens and your Herbert, you know, Baker. These were the two architects. Okay, let's understand the life in the time of partition. What was the life? Okay, as you know that in 1947, when country got independence, right, the India got divided into two dominions, that is the Dominion of India and Pakistan. Okay, which has led to the massive transfer of the territory as well as the transfer of the population also. Okay, so transfer of the population also taken place. Okay, now what happens is this has led to, you know, basically riots. So rioting was basically started. Over a third of Delhi Muslims migrated. Almost 44,000 homes were abandoned, okay, which has also impacted, basically the demography of the Indian side also, because a lot of Muslims basically migrated, but obviously not all Muslims migrated, but few Muslims migrated. Okay, so partition changed the life and the occupations of the new migrants, because some of the migrants from Pakistan also came to India, and few migrants from Pakistan, basically from India, basically left for the Pakistan. So this last migration that was happened, so obviously the social milieu of the Delhi was also changed, because the demography was changed. Okay, the population belongs to the Sikh, Hindu, you know, Christians migrated from Pakistan to India, and specifically the Muslim population migrated from India to Pakistan. As we have seen, almost 2/3 of the Delhi Muslims migrated, right? And 44,000 homes were abandoned, right? Because they feared their life during the partition. Okay, now what was happened inside the old city? So obviously, in the old city, there was excellent system of water supply and the drainage. Okay, so that was basically, this was during the British time, it was neglected, because the Britishers want to forego the legacy of, you know, the Mughals. So a system of wells were completely broken down. Okay, the channels to remove the household waste was completely damaged. So as you have seen that the well-placed water system, water supply system, drainage system was neglected. Okay, and the Sajani drains that was totally closed. Okay, and a new system of open surface drains was basically introduced by the British in the 19th century. So the inside the old city, that was totally, some incidents that were taken place that has, led to, not enough development in the old city. So the decline of the Havelis was also taken place. So as you have seen that the Mughals were basically who were rulers or who were basically having the high position during the Mughal Empire. So the Mughal aristocracy, right, or the Mughal elites in the 17th and the 18th century lives in the grand mansions called Havelis, right? These Havelis were occupied by these Mughal aristocracies or the high class Mughals. Okay, these Havelis were basically having, the grand mansions. That means they have the walled compounds, right, which have the courtyards, which have the mansions, which have the fountains, right? And many families also housed in it. Okay, now what happens is, right, because of the decline of this patronage which was provided by the Mughals, and the patronage by the Britishers was basically not provided. So many of the Mughal Amirs, right, which were unable to maintain these Havelis, right, because under the conditions of the British, they have not given any patronage to those Mughal Amirs. As a result, what happens is, these Havelis, because these Havelis also had different families which house into it. Now these basically started subdividing, and also many such Havelis are basically sold, because they were unable to maintain these Havelis, because they need the huge amount of money to be sustained, and that was happened. So there was decline of Havelis also. Okay, next, the municipalities. Regarding municipalities, you must also understand, the census of 1931 was revealed that the walled city area of Delhi was crowded. Okay, so it was crowded to the extent that the density of population, so density means the number of people living in per unit area. So that is the unit, you can take either acre, or you can take kilometer square, or you can say meter square, or whatever you may take. So generally acre or kilometer square we take. So on that time, the walled city has the density of 90 people per acre. Okay, and New Delhi, that was only about the 3 persons per acre. So you can think of almost 30 times it was as high dense as It was New Delhi. So New Delhi was very sparsely populated at that point of the time. But there was a poor condition, as you have seen that, right? Because of, you know, the adverse drainage conditions, right? Adverse, you know, the water supply, which is led to, right? Some poor conditions, but that also did not stop it from expanding. The old walled city basically expanded. Okay. In 1888, an extension scheme called the Lahore Gate Improvement Scheme was planned. And that was planned by the Robert Clark for the walled city residents, okay, to expand as well as to provide certain amenities to basically to the walled city. And with that process, the Delhi Improvement Trust was basically set up in 1936, right? And it built areas like Dariaganj, right, for the wealthy Indians, okay? Now, different improvement trust was basically set up to expand, to provide those amenities, right, to the wealthy peoples. Okay, next, the weavers, iron smelters, and factory owners. Okay, now you must understand, the Britishers, when they came, okay, so they were mainly focusing on two types of industries, okay? So the British rule mainly focusing on the two types of industry, or the industries basically that were given more importance, that were the textiles and iron and steel. So these two types of industries were mainly focused upon, okay? Obviously, the industrialization at one place have the impact on another place also, because you need the raw material, you need basically the finished product to sell. So all such things basically needed the colonies, all such things needed basically the markets and all such things. So industrialization, the Britain has close connections with the colonization in India, obviously. So as the industrial production basically grow, okay, so where will they sell the this huge product? Obviously, they need the market. So the British industrialists basically saw that India is a vast market for selling their industrial products. So over the year, what happens is the Britishers basically, you know, try to sell as much as their product to the Indian, you know, to the Indian masses. And from India, they collected basically, you know, the raw material, right, that will be ultimately, you know, will be exported to the Britain, and in Britain, from the Britain, you know, basically the manufactured product, right, were basically exported to India for the selling purpose. Okay, so that was the time. And let's understand what was the condition at that point of the time with respect to the Indian textile. So first of all, the India was the world largest producer of the cotton textile on that time, world largest producer. Okay. And India's textile was renowned in the world. It was the fine quality muslin cotton textile that were very famous in almost all Western countries. Okay, so India's, you know, the fine textured, fine quality cotton and muslin was very famous. Okay, in the 16th century, okay, you know, the European traders, specifically from Britain, you know, Portuguese, French, they came for buying off the Indian textiles, ultimately to be sold in the, you know, in the European region. Okay, so that was the time. And, you know, the world tell us about the stories regarding the Indian textiles, right? So Indian textiles were very, very famous in the Western markets, especially in the European markets. Okay, they were named with the different names. For example, they were known as muslin. They were known as calico, that is basically derived from the Calicut, which is in coastal area. Okay, and the printed cotton clothes from India, basically known as chintzidra, right? As well as the bandhana. The bandhana, you know, is still, you know, in India, it is still famous, okay, which is in dye, right? Which is in dyed cloth, right? Were basically ordered in the bulk, specifically from India. Okay, so Indian clothes, specifically the cotton clothes, were very famous, right, in the Western markets, in the European markets, okay? And they were known with the different names, muslins, calico, chinch, bandhana. So they were famous and they were basically ordered in the bulk also. Okay. Now, as the Britishers industrialization, as the Britain industrialization basically occurred, so what happens is they have seen that Indian cotton, which is a rival to the British industrial development. So what they have done, they have enacted a legislation that banned the printed cotton textile, that is called chinch in England. So the British government basically banned the import of Indian printed cotton textile, that is called chinch in England. Okay. So that was basically, you know, Indian designs that were imitated and printed in England, right, on the white Muslims and the plains, right, which was unbleached Indian cloth. And in 1764, right, the spinning jenny was invented by John Key, who was basically, you know, an industrialist. And invention of the steam engine, right, which was done by the Richard Arkwright in 1786, further revolutionized this industrialization and opening of different economies in the world. And it also revolutionized the cotton textile weaving, right, in the England as well as slowly in the other part of the world also. So who were weavers, right? Obviously, the weavers were those community who are specialized in weaving of the clothes. So they belong to the community that are specialized in the weaving. Okay, so they were, you know, the weavers were basically used to have the handloom weaving process. Okay, that were basically, you know, associated with those people, right, which provided the occupation or livelihood to the millions of the Indians. Okay, so what happens is with the invention of this, the automatic textiles, or the industrialization in the Britain has led to the decline of the Indian textile. So that was happened. So the development of cotton industries in the Britain affected the textile producers in India in many ways. So first of all, England started making the cotton textiles, right, which have banned the Indian textiles in the Britain, okay, and which has successfully ousted the Indian goods or Indian textile items or Indian, you know, cotton items from the traditional markets in Africa, America, and the Europe. And because the Britishers started making these textiles, so they have blocked the India's export from the India to the Africa, America, and Europe, and ultimately they have captured these markets in those areas also. Okay. And all the European powers, right, as well as the English powers started, you know, stopped completely buying of Indian goods also. Okay. And by 1830s, right, you know, almost they have blocked India's clothes in the European markets, in the England market, as well as they tried their best to, you know, to get access Indian market, right, with respect to their own clothes. So British manufactured clothes basically reached out to the Indian markets also. Okay. And those people who were basically, you know, live or have the livelihood of options with respect to those, you know, those handlooms, right, handloom weaving process. So they were spinning this cotton thread, right? So with that, the cheap clothes basically entered into the Indian market that was factory made. So what happens is the many people, or especially the rural people who were dependent on this spinning of cotton thread, they lost their jobs. Obviously, right? And even Mahatma Gandhi urged the people to boycott the imported textiles because it has led to the de-urbanization, it has led to the loss of livelihood, it has led to the decline of industrialization in India. It is adversely impacting the economy of India. It is a totally drain of wealth from India to the Britain. Okay, so that was the time during the national movement also, Mahatma Gandhi urged the people of India to boycott imported textiles and obviously use the hand-spun and hand-woven clothes that was mainly derived from the Indian weaving tradition, and as well as the khadi become the symbol of the nationalism in India. So that was with the effort of Mahatma Gandhi, which have changed the path from this, you know, the British-made clothes to the hand-woven clothes, khadi, etc. Okay, which is also the most important aspect of your, you know, the replacement of the British, you know, goods in India. So that was also the time when the Britishers tried to gain control over the Indian markets, okay, which is also the most important aspect during that point of the time. All right, so that's all for today. We'll meet tomorrow for our next lecture. Thank you very much.